shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will.
And good morning once more. It is wonderful to gather together in the house of the Lord. And you know that our hearts will be united together in worship today. If you're new to our church, thank you for joining us. There's a little thing called a kit card, which means keeping in touch. It's a way for you to kind of let us know who you are and also for us to start connect with you. So you can do that online. You can pick up a card out at our welcome table. And we just appreciate you being here with us. A few things in the life of our church to be made known. Our soccer coaches, we're excited about soccer season starting up in May. We are thrilled that we're down to only, we need about 18 more coaches out of 60. So that's fantastic to see that all coming together. And just a reminder that coaches, your training session is on Tuesday, May 14th. And so start making sure you're ready for that. The actual league starts on the 21st, so be prepared for all those kind of things. Another volunteer opportunity for you. Every Thursday evening, Cobb's Bakery up in Ancaster donates a whole bunch of bread for us to give out at our Friday morning Coffees On program. It's part of our food bank, and we have 30 to 50 people each week that come and share in that. And we need some help picking that up on Thursday nights. We've got a team already. We've had kind of some changes. And we need someone particularly for the third Thursday. That happens every month, obviously. And the fifth Thursday, which happens occasionally. So if you'd be willing to help us out by learning what you have to do, 7 p.m., you arrive at Cobb's, pick up a whole bunch of bags of bread, put it in your car, come back to the church here with it, and then have to bag it up a little bit further after that. So if you'd like to help us out with that, get in touch with the church office. That would be great for you to help us out that way. And then on Sunday, May 5th, we're having our next worship night. This is an evening just to come together and worship the Lord in an extended period of time. Our worship team, Jesse, Andrew's involved in that, and they just lead a wonderful evening of coming and singing and praying together and being united and just brought into the presence of the Lord together. So May 5th, 7:30 p.m. is our next opportunity for that. Again, put it into your calendars and be aware of what's coming. And then next is on Wednesday, May the 1st, just a week this Wednesday, we're having our information night for Camp Wajidouin. This is for parents, if you're interested and just kind of wondering that what that looks like to send your kids to camp, come and find out, and we can just spread it all out and say, this is what happens at camp, these are how the cabins work, this is how cabin leaders work, all those kind of things, because this is a combination of kids from our neighborhood come, kids from our church come. We want you to be prepared for what that looks like. And also volunteers. We need a whole team of people to come and help us for that week of camp. Things like the kitchen, things like maintenance, things like being a cabin leader. We need to provide all of those kind of leadership positions. We need you to help us out with all that. So Wednesday, May 1st, 7:30, here at the church, we are, well, I say we, it's really Derek and Michaela will lay all that out to you. They will fill you all in with all the details on. So that's what's coming up. You get the notice, you get information, be aware and come and participate. Participate in all of those ways. Stand with me now as we come before the Lord. Let me pray for us and then we'll sing to the Lord together. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for gathering us in this place. Thank you that you have called us, you've reminded us, you've anointed us to be here, this divine appointment to meet with you this morning. We thank you for all the things that are taking place this morning, some special moments of baptism and commissioning. God, use all of these things in our heart, along with your word, by your spirit, to draw us into your presence now. We thank you for this in Christ our Savior's name. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, James North. In 1 John 3, verse 1, it says, See what kind of love the Father has given unto us, that we might be called children of God. And so we are. I love that last part. And so we are. If you are in Jesus Christ this morning, that is true of you. And so we're going to sing that reality in this next song. We are children of God by grace and grace alone. lost at the fall, running away when I'd hear you call. Father, you worked your will. I had no righteousness of my own. I had no right to draw near your throne. But Father, you love me still. And in love before you laid the world's foundation, you predestined to adopt me as your own. You have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace and grace alone. It's our example of Jesus. You left your home.
You left your home to seek out the lost. You knew the great and terrible cost. But Jesus, your face was set. I worked my fingers down to the bone, but nothing I did could ever atone. Jesus, you paid my debt. By your blood I have redemption and salvation. You died that I might reap what you have sown, and you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone.
I was in darkness. Darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. Spirit, you made me see. I swore I knew the way on my own. Head full of rocks, a heart made of stone. Spirit, you moved in me. And at your touch, my sleeping spirit was awakened. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Called into a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Heaven citizen by grace and grace alone. So I'll stand. So I'll stand in faith by grace and grace alone. I will run the race by grace and grace alone. I sin by grace and grace alone. And I will reach the end by grace and grace alone.
Amen. Grab your seats. We're actually going to move into a time of baptism now. And at this time, I'm going to invite Annika and her parents up for the baptism. But I just want to start off by explaining a little bit about what we're doing. So we're moving into this time now where Annika is going to be baptized. And this is a symbol of what God has been doing in Annika's heart, in her life. This is the saving work of Christ that Annika has had her heart opened up to, that she is now going to profess to you today through this act of baptism. And I'm going to read just from 1 Peter chapter 3. I want you to hear these words. Starting in verse 18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him. So this is what we're celebrating today, that God died, that he rose again, and he now sits at the right hand of God over all the authorities, and through that, he's allowed those who call on his name to be saved. And today, Annika is doing that in front of everybody, and when she goes under the water, that's her symbolically declaring that she's putting to death her old life ruled by sin and rising with Christ into the new life that he died to give her. And so Annika is going to share a little bit about what that looks like in her life for us.
I grew up in a strong faith-based family, and it was always inspiring for me to see the love and full trust in the Lord that they had. I always wanted to have that faith, so I went to Sunday school, church, youth group, and OPC Bible camp, and I loved it, but I also often felt like I was missing the connection to the Lord that others had. I had knew the gospel, but didn't have the connections that I knew others had. I just assumed that he would show himself in a great big sign like Moses in the burning bush, but it wasn't happening. Because of this, I found myself living through my family's faith and not my own, causing me to stumble in my journey as a Christian. Made me feel it's just not meant to be. I would start overthinking and made myself believe I'm not worthy of his love. So I put other things in front of him. And if I meant to be a Christian, God would tell me. I had the knowledge of who God is, and I loved him, and I knew I was a Christian, but I did not have my own faith because I was living through my family's faith. Unaware, it was never what I put first. After putting my time and effort in other things like school, friendships, or anything, I thought I could find value in that I could accomplish myself, but it was never enough because I am not perfect, and nothing I could do alone was perfect, so I wasn't fulfilled. Over the summer, I got a job at the camp here as a counselor. I absolutely adored it, and God showed himself to me through the job, but not the way I had subconsciously been waiting for. He showed himself through me with the coworkers and campers. While I was working, I witnessed the gifts God had given the coworkers around me. I could see how God had blessed each one and how the love for him glowed off of them. And it showed me that what he says in the Bible is true, and that he indeed has plans and has given gifts to everyone of his creation, showing the proof I wanted. I could see how he was using the people around me to show himself to me. I realized God had been calling me, and he has been calling me the whole time to have my own faith and to show the arrows that I was oblivious to. And after the summer, when I made my relationship with Christ a priority, I realized that I was too busy focusing on that big sign. I missed all the little signs he was placing right in front of me the whole time. Because Christ has made me aware of the love he has for me and the forgiveness he's given me, and that he has a plan for me no matter if I'm not perfect, I now have a faith that is my own. The Lord worked in my life with his grace and mercy and lots of patience and will continue to work in my life, which led me to be here knowing I need to get baptized.
So, Annika, do you confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And is it in your intent to be baptized as a symbol of your faith in Jesus?
Yes. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
We're just going to pray for Annika. Dear God, I just thank you so much for this gift that you've given Pete and I, that we can raise, and the work that you're doing in her life. God, I give it to you. I think as a parent, we just pray and hope and trust that you are working, and you are. So we thank you, God, for that. God, we just pray for Annika. Continue to work in her life. We thank you for the work you have done, and we just pray that you will continue to work and use her in your kingdom. yeah, we just pray for her joy and her love and her sparkle just to flourish and to grow and to serve others. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
All right. So if you have been thinking through baptism, if declaring your faith to God and to the community that you're in is something that's been on your heart, your mind, we'd love to chat with you and help you figure that out. We have another baptism service coming up on May 12th, and we got room, and we're willing to fill this up whenever we need to. So come and chat with one of the staff members at some point if this is something you're thinking through. And we're going to continue on in praise now.
I invite you all to stand. We're going to continue to sing, continue to celebrate the good work of our Lord, saying, "Great are you, Lord, for all he has done." Praise you only. our breath to say, great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord. Great are you,
Lord, you are great, and we praise you with all of who we are, with all of our mind, our strength, for you are our God and our Savior. We praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please go ahead and have a seat. It really is an exciting day for a church. We get to witness a baptism. That was wonderful. But we also get to set aside this morning someone for ministry, a commissioning of a young adult who's now entering into the workforce of ministry. And so we want to call up Mary McKenzie to come stand with me. And she'll invite Scott Davis. I didn't get to meet Scott. I heard he was here, though. Hi, Scott. I'm Dave.
Nice to meet you.
Scott is Mary's supervisor, and so I've asked Scott to come and share a little bit about the ministry of Youth Unlimited, Youth for Christ in Waterdown. This is our way, this commissioning is our way as a church of saying we stand with Mary. We support her in this. We think this is a good route for her, and we want to encourage Mary in this morning. For me, Youth Unlimited, Youth for Christ, I've had a long history with it. I was the steering team chair for the Kawartha Lakes chapter. We helped partner with them for a karate program, for soccer camp and whatnot. And I've got all kinds of friends that work and serve within Youth Unlimited across Canada. And so I'm excited for you, Mary, for what you're doing. And Scott, I'd love for you to share a little bit with us about what the work is like, what's happening in the Waterdown satellite.
Yeah, I am Scott Davis. I am the program director at Youth Unlimited Waterdown, and we have a variety of different programs. Our biggest program is our lunch program. So we have a high school that's about 10 minute walk away, and we serve free food to those students. We get anywhere between 80 and 150 students on a daily basis. Thankfully, two lunch periods means that they are separated. We also run an archery program as well as a girls club, and we have a few relationships where we can do one-on-one. We have some leadership training, lots of really fun stuff, and we are very excited to have Mary coming on. We hope that she will be able to get into the schools, coaching the hockey teams, joining us with our lunch program, and even coming up with whatever she decides to, or however she decides to serve the students. So we are very excited for her. Mm.
Thank you, Scott. Yeah, it's amazing. I love how watching all the different chapters have their own ministries, and they do what's been gifted to the people who are serving. And so we look forward to what the Lord has in mind for you. At this time, I want to call up the elders to come up, and we're gonna pray over Mary as we commission her into this ministry today. I've asked our chairman Dave Heska to pray for Mary from a personal perspective. Tim Laws is going to pray for her vocationally, for her minister, her job itself. Pastor Paul's going to pray for her ministry, and I will close off praying for you spiritually as we begin this ministry.
Crowd over, guys. We hand this over closer so we can Tim. Put some hands on Mary here.
All right, would you all stand with us? Stand with us and show your support by standing, and let's pray.
God, we are thankful for this morning that we can come here to you, the everlasting one, who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And as finite creatures, God, we come to you who is infinite. As weak people, we come to you who is powerful, and we bring our sister Mary before you. God, we praise you for her life. Thank you for the time she was able to share, even with us a few weeks ago, your work, her testimony, and how, God, you've been even just preparing the way for this ministry that she will have with the students and the youth there in Waterdown and throughout Hamilton. God, thank you for the ministry of Youth for Christ, for Youth Unlimited. And as we've just heard, God, we ask that you would bless that ministry and her work there with the students who come to the lunch program, God, who are searching, who are running away from you, who may not even have heard of you. God, I pray that the words that come out of her mouth, the actions as she loves them and just plays sports with them and is a great godly example, God, would you bless her? We pray, God, too, that as she ministers, Lord, you would pour your spirit into her and that she would, from a Christ-like character, become more and more Jesus-like you. Amen. God, that she would put off her old self and put on her new self that's being renewed day by day. And God, we ask that you would keep her healthy, keep her physically healthy, keep her emotionally healthy, keep her mentally healthy. God, protect this woman as she serves you, we ask.
Father, we thank you for this opportunity that you've given Mary to serve with Youth Unlimited in Waterdown. And God, we thank you for the gifts and abilities that you have blessed her with. And God, we pray that she will grow in her skills and abilities. God, to walk alongside youth both through their joys and sorrows. God, to speak the truth in love, to declare the gospel boldly as she should. God, to be able to do the administrative duties and all the technical parts of her work with excellence. God, continue to grow her in her gifts and abilities. And God, I pray that you will also continue to grow her in her character and in her likeness of you. And it's in your great name that we pray.
Lord God, we thank you for how you have called Mary into this journey with you, and that she as a disciple has grown under the tutelage of others and watched you and has conformed into your image. And now we pray that you are going to bless her in a fruitful ministry with others, that you would grant her the ability to disciple, to see kids that are in high school and others surrounding her, that they would see in her the model of Jesus Christ, of salvation, of discipleship, of coming to faith and growing in that. So Lord, bless her with a fruitful ministry, a ministry that will cause you to be seen and your kingdom to grow and for people to grow up in Jesus Christ. And so help her in all these things, we pray, oh God.
And Father, as Mary begins this new season in her life, as she steps out to serve you in her work, we know that there's one who's not happy about that. And we recognize, Father, that spiritual warfare is very, very real. And God, as she begins, we pray that you would protect her by your spirit, protect her from the arrows of the evil one, that she may not be hindered in the work she does. Protect her her faith, protect her character as she serves. And God, we pray that through this, she would see fruit, see much fruit through the work she does with the youth in Waterdown. And God, may we be able to celebrate with her in the coming months and years of all the stories of kids and youth who are making those steps closer and closer to Christ. God, we just pray again that you would just watch over her and care for her and protect her in this season. We thank you for her. We praise you for calling her into your work. We pray in the name of our Son, of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
You can stay standing because we're going to sing a song. And as we sing this next song, the kids, it's time to head down for your Kingdom Kids program. That goes up to grade 5 today. Junior highs, you're staying in the room. So as we sing, you can make your way downstairs.
Oh, sweet. Annika's back. Okay. We're going to sing a song we haven't done before, but it's a song that's meant a lot in Annika's life. But I also think it's a really applicable song for where Mary's into. It's just a song that that testifies to the trustworthiness of our God, that he will never fail, both in the spiritual journey ahead of Annika and in Mary's life ahead of ministry. So let's sing this out together. Blessed assurance,
Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. What He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Oh, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Never fail. He will never fail.
You are the God who will never fail. And God, as we at this moment take some time to look into your word, would you teach us today? Would you make yourself famous, make yourself glorious through what we read in your word this morning? We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and have a seat. Well, this morning we are coming to the end of a series. This is the end of our Choosing Jesus series. If you remember, this series really started back in the beginning of December with our Christmas series as we've walked all the way through Luke. And coming to the end of this series, we're coming to this highlight at the end of Luke. Sometimes endings are dreaded. Sometimes endings are like unwelcome. We don't want endings to come. Although sometimes endings are exciting and we look forward to some things ending, right? Is it a fear of the unknown of what's next? Or is it an excitement or a fear of missing out? But one thing's for sure, with every ending comes a new beginning. Every ending is a new beginning. This week was a week of endings and beginnings for us as a family. We ended being residents of the city of Kawartha Lakes this week. On Monday, we packed up our house, we moved out of Fenland Falls, and we began a new chapter as residents of Hamilton. Yeah. 5 months of being in two places is not fun. I don't recommend it for anyone. I am so glad that we can now be here and close. But that ending itself was a little difficult because as much as we were excited to be coming to the new beginning, we had to end some things, ending where we lived and where we shopped and especially the friends that we have who are still there. Those endings are difficult, even though we look forward to being this new beginning. And speaking of fearing endings, I want to tell you about myself as a high school student. If you want a model high school student, I am not the kid. I was not a model high school student. Don't show me to your teenager from those years. I mean, don't get me wrong, I loved my high school. Dr. F.J. Donovan Collegiate Institute in Oshawa doesn't exist anymore. It got torn down. It's now townhouses. Actually, all of my public schools got torn down. So should I warn Heritage? This is my pattern? I don't know. Anyways, I was proud to be a Blue Devil. Yes, we were the Blue Devils. I was actually even more proud to be in the bands, in the senior bands. In fact, our stage band, in my last year of high school, we went to Hackensack, New Jersey for a music festival, and we came in second. Does it change if I tell you there's two bands in the contest? I shouldn't have told you that. But in high school, I played some football. I played men's doubles badminton. I was in a bunch of bands. I loved going to high school, but I was a terrible student. In fact, I loved being at high school so much, I was willing to go back for a sixth year. So back when I was in high school, there was 4 or 5 years, the OACs. Grade 13 was a thing. Some of you don't remember that, but grade 13 was a thing. I was willing to go back for a sixth year, but my mom kind of persuaded me to go to college. I was afraid of ending the high school. I didn't want what was after that, but I am so grateful now for that encouragement to get started, because by ending my time in high school, I was able to begin my college years. I was able to then go and travel the world with a traveling music team. I was able to get a job, a full-time job, and even better, I was able to convince Katie to marry me. She had one lapse in judgment in her life, and that was it. But see, if I hadn't come to grips with ending high school, I never would have moved on to the new beginning of what was going to happen after that. The ending of my high school is the beginning of college for me. And sometimes the ending of high school for some is the beginning of a career. And the ending of working is the beginning of retirement, and the ending of church is the beginning of lunch. We're often fearful of these endings, though. We don't know what lies around the corner. We're not sure how things are going to go. And so we tend to like the comfort of what we know, right? We say it's the devil we know. We're comfortable with what we know. But sometimes, and maybe even often, that new beginning is so much better for us if we can just get over the fact we don't want to go there. And there's actually an ending and a beginning in our Bible. We don't talk about it very often, at least in the evangelical circles I've been in. We put a lot of focus on Christmas, right? We have spent a whole month celebrating Christmas. We spend time looking at Palm Sunday and Good Friday and Easter, the big holidays, the big holy holidays for us. But what we don't often talk about is the one that comes 40 days after the resurrection. That's the ascension of Jesus. And we find that the ascension is actually a great example of an ending that becomes a new beginning. See, after the resurrection, Jesus wasn't just sitting around with his feet up. He was out continuing his ministry. He was teaching his disciples, spending time with his disciples, hundreds of them at a time. And certainly the cross and the tomb are a central place in the story of our Christian faith. But don't be fooled that the ascension is just some afterthought and God had to figure out some ways to end this thing. The ascension marks the end of one stage of Jesus' ministry, but also marks the beginning of a new stage for him. And so as we bring this series to a close, I want to look at this event and hopefully better understand its significance. If you have your Bible, open up to Luke chapter 24. We're going to be in Luke 24, and then we're actually going to be in Acts chapter 1 for most of our morning this morning. So where are we in this? We are at the end of Luke. These are the last three verses of Luke, the very end where we find out what happens at the end of the story. So a few weeks ago, we celebrated Easter. Right? We celebrated the resurrection of Jesus. We heard from Derek a couple weeks ago about the road to Emmaus when Jesus walked with a couple of disciples and shared with them all about how the scriptures all pointed to him. Those were the appearances. Pastor Paul last week shared with us about the assurances from Jesus as he met with his disciples in that locked room. If you haven't actually seen those or heard those sermons, you do know we have a YouTube page with the videos on it. You can go watch them. I would encourage you to go do that. You know, subscribe, smash that like button for us. I wasn't going to say that, but then it came out. But did you know we also have it audio form on our church website? So if you're like someone who likes to listen to podcasts when you drive or when you're working out, you can get the actual audio from our church website, jamesnorth.church. It's a great tool, a great resource for us all to go back and listen to what we've been taught here. So I would encourage you to go back and listen to Derek and Paul's messages from the last 2 weeks if you haven't heard them already. So Luke chapter 24, let me read you verses 50 to 53. Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple blessing God. So here we have Jesus taking his disciples out to Bethany, a very familiar place for them. Remember, they had spent a fair bit of time there. That's where Mary and Martha and Lazarus were. That's where Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. A familiar spot for them to go, a welcome spot for them. And while they're there, Jesus lifts up his hands, Luke says, and he blesses them. And after he does that, he's carried up into heaven. The disciples worship, they return to Jerusalem. There's not a whole lot here about that event. Very, very little, actually. But even this ending of Luke has a new beginning. So I've asked you now to turn to Acts chapter 1. So Luke and Acts are both written by Luke. Sometimes it's called Luke Acts or 1st and 2nd Luke. And what we find is that Luke actually begins Acts with a more full story, more full telling of the event of the ascension. Listen to this as I read it, and we'll hop in with a few little pieces as we go. He says, Acts 1, chapter 1, verse 1. In the first book, O Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach. It's almost like he's saying, like, previously on the writings of Luke, right? You know, you watch this, the, the beginning of a show, and it tells you what's happened previously. So what Luke's doing, he's catching up his readers for this. And so we think of Luke. Luke is a gospel of Jesus Christ. And a gospel is a genre of writing considered to be ancient Greco-Roman biography. Those are writings that were often done about someone in particular shortly after they had died. And so we consider this to be a gospel, to be one of these biographies. And we talk about Luke being the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think I would propose that we could look at Acts as being the gospel of the church. It's kind of like the biography of the church, how it gets going. It's actually titled the Acts of the Apostles. And it was, someone said to me recently, you could think of it as the Acts of the Holy Spirit, which really is that as well. But think of it as the gospel of the church. So Luke is saying, hey, I've already written to you all about Jesus. I want to give you more information. He says, until the day when he was taken up after he had given commands through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. Luke's referring to the commands that Jesus had given. In context, at the ascension, really what he's talking about is the Great Commission, which Luke doesn't really give us very clearly, but Matthew is where we go to the Great Commandment, or as Dan Spader calls it from Sun Life Ministries, he calls that the Everyday Commission. We think of it as this big grand thing that only certain people do, or you only do it once in a while, but really it's an everyday commission. This should be our life. We should be breathing this in and out. It says this, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. This is kind of the last command that Jesus gives his disciples before he ascends. This is their marching orders. I've talked before a bit about like how the great commandment, right, love God, love others, is kind of a singular. If you look at the Greek, it's singular. It's to you individually to love God and love others. But the great commandment is kind of like a y'all, like all of you as a group to the church, to the disciples, go make more disciples. And this command actually has one command in here. And the one command is make disciples. That's it. It's simple. Make disciples. There's some adverbs, some things describing this, clarifiers, right? How do we do it? Well, we go, first of all. And go for some of us means going somewhere far away. But also could be just taken in as you are going. As you go on your way, whatever you're doing, make disciples. And then it tells us how to do that. You do that by baptizing, which we were blessed to witness this morning, and also by teaching them to obey what he's commanded, to teach others, the disciples, how to follow Christ. So we need to come back to these verses a lot. But really, these are the purpose of the church. This is why we exist. We need to do this. We come together to encourage, to support, to learn. But really, it shouldn't end here. When you walk out that door, you should be starting to share with others what you know about Christ. It's all about making disciples. And I question, if we're not making disciples, are we even really a church? Let's go on. Verse 3, he presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Jesus reassures his disciples. I mean, they were likely nervous and anxious still. They probably wanted to return to their old life, right? Back to what they knew. Jesus knew this. I mean, he called them out on this before. He said, oh, you of little faith. Why is your faith so small? And so, but he's reassuring them here. He says, just hold tight. Just wait. Because the promise from the Father is coming. He says, you're going to be baptized by the Holy Spirit. And so when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? They still didn't really understand the plan. They now knew, they saw the resurrected Jesus. They knew who he was. They knew that he is risen from the dead. They knew that he was Messiah. They knew that he was king. But they didn't understand the when or the where. They say, is it now? But again, Jesus says to them, it's not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. It's not for you to worry about that, guys. You don't need to worry about when the kingdom and when I'm going to sit on the throne or where I'm going to sit on the throne. Don't worry about that. It's kind of like the serenity prayer. Do you know the serenity prayer? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. In other words, focus your energy on what you can do. Jesus says, do what I've called you to do. Don't worry about my stuff. Don't dwell on what's out my work. See, our role is to be obedient to our call of being disciple makers. We don't have control out of outcomes. We don't actually make Christians, but we have a responsibility to be obedient to the call to make disciples, to go and teach and tell people about Jesus. There's that old saying, right? I'm just a beggar showing other beggars where to find bread. Don't worry about my things. Worry about your things, he says in verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And he says to them, don't worry. You're not in this alone. Like the Father's going to send the Spirit. And when he does, you are going to be witnesses. You are going to do this. You're going to do what I've trained you to do. And you're going to spread the gospel. It's going to go out in concentric circles. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. He's giving them hope for their future. And here it is. When he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up and a cloud took him out of their sight. Dramatic fashion. Could you imagine being there with Jesus and the other disciples? He's talking to you and all of a sudden, he's raised up into the clouds. It's interesting, this idea of up, right? The ascension means going up, ascended. Up is the direction Jesus went, up into the clouds, up into heaven. There's this recurring motif throughout all of Scripture about going up to meet with God. Think back even to Genesis 1:1, okay? We'll start at the very beginning. God created the heavens and the earth. Both of those are God's domain. But God has given us as humanity some responsibility and some dominion over the earth. We have a responsibility here. But we consider the heavens to be God's domain. We consider that's where he is. So we think of up is where heaven is. Right? In the same way, we think of hell and Hades and Sheol as being below, like under the ground. Ezekiel 28 kind of gives us the idea that the Garden of Eden actually might have been up on a hill, on a mountain. It was up on the holy mountain of God. Exodus 28, God commands Moses and his fellow leaders to do what? To come up Mount Sinai to worship. Leviticus 16 and 17, wait, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the festival for the Jewish people. The high priest symbolically goes up. He ascends to meet with God. Even 2 Samuel 6, King David establishes Jerusalem as the city of God, the holy city. And where is it? It's up the hills in the center of Israel's tribes. So when the pilgrims would come to Jerusalem, it's always said they're going up. Whether they're going north or actually physically going up, or going up to Jerusalem. They even sing their psalms of what? Of ascent. Up. And you notice something interesting? And that most of these examples of going up to meet with God beforehand, there's been a sacrifice. Moses gave a sacrifice before going up. The high priest gives a sacrifice before going up. Jesus travels up to Jerusalem, where he is arrested. He's put on trial. He's condemned. And then what happens? He walks up to Golgotha. and then he's raised up on a cross where he becomes our sacrifice for our sins. Before 3 days later being raised up from the dead. There's something to this idea of being up, of ascending, of ascension. And Luke tells us that when Jesus left, he ascended into heaven. He went up into the heavens, into the clouds. And as he does that, two angels are there. While they were gazing into heaven, as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into the heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." They almost sarcastically ask, "What are you looking for? He's gone. He's up. He's gone back to heaven." But again, they reassure them, "But don't worry. He's going to come back just the same way as he's gone up." And I think I mentioned this on Easter, that I've got a friend who used to say that, "See that cloud? That could be the cloud. Jesus may come back on that cloud." Always watching, always waiting, always excited. This is a story, an event that I learned about as a kid growing up, but it never really came with much explanation, just narration. But I assure you, this is not just a story. It's an actual event. Jesus really did live. Jesus really did die. Jesus really did rise again. And Jesus really did go up into heaven. And just like everything else God does, this has a purpose. It has meaning. There's an ending. Jesus leaves, but there's a beginning. The ascension of Christ completes Jesus' earthly mission. And it signifies his enthronement as the heavenly king. There's a number of ways we see this. And the first thing is this: the ascension may be the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, but it's the beginning of Jesus' heavenly ministry. Jesus came to this earth and he lived and taught and he corrected misunderstandings. He did his work of redeeming mankind. And when we look at the four Gospels, we see a little bit about Jesus and his birth. We see even less about his childhood and adolescence. We see nothing for like 18 years. But most of the Gospels is the time he spent in ministry, doing the things he came to do, coming to fulfill the Father's kingdom agenda. He poured his life into a group of 12 disciples and a larger group of disciples. He taught them about the kingdom. He healed the sick. He did mighty miracles. He fed the multitudes. He set the religious rulers straight in their misunderstanding of the Torah. And he declared that he would build his church and that his church would not be defeated by the gates of hell. Something I didn't understand about that until a few years ago. I always thought of that as the gates of hell were attacking, but they're not going to win. Do gates attack? No, gates don't. Gates are defensive. Jesus said, "I'm going to build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail." What does that mean? It means the church is storming the gates of hell. We are going after them, not the opposite way around. And those gates will not stand. They will not prevail. Keep that encouragement. Jesus lived a perfect, sinless life, the only way that he could become the perfect sacrificial lamb for our sin. He was the sacrifice to end all sacrifices. And all that Jesus did on this earth was amazing. It was great. And it would have been fine, it would have been good if he could have continued doing the work he was doing. But if he had not ascended, if he had stayed here on this earth, he could not have returned and began his next phase. We would not have had these. We would not have had Jesus as our advocate. And we wouldn't have had the Holy Spirit as a helper or comforter. This next phase of his ministry couldn't have begun if he had stayed and kept working here. His death and resurrection secured our forgiveness, our justification, our reconciliation with God, But without returning to heaven, we would not have our advocate in the presence of the Father. He has this heavenly ministry of interceding on behalf of us. 1 Timothy 2:5. If there is one God and there is one mediator between God and men, the man, Jesus Christ. 1 John 2:1, my little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Isn't that reassuring and comforting? Our Savior is advocating on our behalf. And as our advocator, as our intercessor, it's reassuring to know that he understands our plight. He walked in our shoes on this earth. He had been tempted by Satan. He's not unaware of what we're going through. Hebrews 4:15, we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. In Hebrews 8:1, now the point in what we are saying is this, we have such a high priest, one who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty on high. He is our king and our advocate. And even now, he's not just sitting on the throne waiting, but his work has changed from face-to-face discipleship of man to face-to-face interceding for man before the Father. And he's advocating for us from a place of personal experience. It was the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, but it's the beginning of Jesus' heavenly ministry. Second thing is this, the ascension may be the end of Jesus as God with us, but it's the beginning of the Holy Spirit as God with us. Matthew quoted Isaiah, who prophesied hundreds of years before Jesus was born, that the Messiah would come and he would be Emmanuel. He would be God with us. Right? In Matthew 1, we read, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. And that was Jesus. He stepped into his own creation to live as one of us, fully God, fully man, walking around his own creation. I mean, his healings, his miracles are meant to show that he's not just some other man. He's not just some guy claiming to be Messiah. He was proving to us that he really is Messiah. He's doing signs and wonders as proof of his deity. And he cared for the downcast. He cared for the oppressed as only God could. But as we saw in his ministry, he could only do that in one place at one time. He was able to be God with us wherever he was, but not wherever he wasn't. But when Jesus ascended to the heaven, to God, back to his Father, he sent the Spirit to be God with us. John 16:7, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away, for if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. It's the beginning of the Holy Spirit as God with us. The message here for the disciples is don't be worried or upset that Jesus is leaving. Because if he was going to stay, the Holy Spirit couldn't come. But if he leaves, the Spirit can come and continue to be God with us in all places at all times. The ascension may be the end of Jesus as humble servant, but it's the beginning of Jesus as sovereign king. He really was the ultimate example of a humble servant, of some who had every right to be king. He was a true servant leader. In reference to his true power, he never lorded it over anyone. And he went to the cross, willingly submitted. We looked at that on Palm Sunday, right? Jesus comes into town on a donkey, a humble donkey, as a peaceful king. He told his disciples explicitly, even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He came to serve. And not long before his arrest, in fact, he took the place of a servant and he washed the feet of his disciples. But when he ascended, he took his place on the throne at the right hand of God the Father. Tim Keller puts it this way. He controls all things for the church, and therefore you can face the world with peace in your heart. He's at the right hand of God as the executive director of history, directing everything for the benefit of the church. If you belong to him, then everything that happens ultimately happens for you. He sits and he reigns as sovereign king over not just Israel, not just over this earth, but over the universe. And we can look forward, though, to the next ending, which is also a new beginning. The second coming of Christ will be the end of the church age, but it's the beginning of the eternal kingdom. When Jesus came to this earth, the kingdom of God began. It was near. He talked about being here and close. We talk about that as being the now and the not yet, or the already and the not yet. He said that in a number of times, Jesus did. But we know that it's not here even now in its fullness. We look around us, even with the life we live, we know we're not in that perfect kingdom. But one day he will come back. We're promised that. He is coming back to take us to be with him. And when that day comes, his reign as king will be fully realized on this earth. I love the imagery of Revelation 19. Verses 11 to 16. Close your eyes and just listen and imagine and visualize what this looks like. This is John writing. Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems, and he has a name written that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What an incredible image. That's our Savior, our King, coming back. And when we pray the Lord's Prayer, we're praying for that day. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The beautiful thing about that, there's no end to that. Until that day that Jesus returns, we'll have endings and beginnings and endings and beginnings. But when he returns, it's an ending and a beginning that has no end. Every ending has a new beginning. Jesus served and walked this earth, teaching, sharing, showing that he is Messiah. He's the one who died on the cross for our sins. But praise God, he rose again on the third day. And as we see from this passage today, he ascended into heaven to be with God the Father, waiting for the day that he returns for his church. Let me close with a few implications of Jesus' ascension for our lives today. Remember that Jesus is present and reigning as king. He remains active and engaged in our world, in our lives, as our advocate. Remember that. He is there advocating for you. And because of that, we should live boldly, confidently, strategically, as his servants, the exalted King of heaven. And in that, know that your labors are not in vain. Do what he's called you to do. And there'll be times when we will be suffering. And when we're suffering, take heart. Jesus is not indifferent to your struggle. He's walked that path. He knows what you're going through. He understands. Take your cares to him. He's our advocate with the Father. He can respond with all of heaven's authority. When you're going through that suffering time, remember that. He is our advocate in heaven. And then hope in the glorious future. That ascended Lord will return one day. He will return to take us to be with him. He will return as judge. He will return as king. He will abolish injustice. Who wants to see justice abolished? Hopefully everyone. He'll end suffering. He'll destroy death. And he'll set up his kingdom of truth, of righteousness, and love. Best of all, he will be our king and we will be with him forever. God will dwell with his people for eternity. So as we wrap up choosing Jesus, I want to leave you with one question. What are you going to do with Jesus? Are you going to choose Jesus or not? I mean, we look at not choosing Jesus, right? Our current culture, when they hear the name Jesus, for many people, it's just a word they use. It's a swear word. It's a curse. To them, it has no connection to Christmas or Easter or anything in the church. There was a former culture that maybe some of us grew up in where most people actually knew about Jesus. They had an idea of what that meant, that Jesus was connected to the church somehow or this thing called the Bible. Maybe it was because we used to say the Lord's Prayer in school. They knew about Jesus. But see, both of those categories are not choosing Jesus. See, when you choose Jesus, when you are someone who's in the church, who's chosen Jesus, we ultimately get to continue to choose Jesus. We don't just know about him, we actually know him. We call him Lord and Savior, the healer, the Christ. He's the one who's the author of our salvation. There really is a practical consequence of answering that question. The question and answer has eternal consequences, positive or negative. If that's the case, would you agree it's an important question to answer? If you choose Jesus, you're choosing a life with him here in present in the now and for eternity. If you're not choosing Jesus, you're walking away from him. The Apostle Paul says this in 2 Corinthians 6. In a favorable time I listened to you. In a day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. What are you going to do with Jesus? Have you even considered that? Have you thought that through? Choosing Jesus isn't a one-time decision either. You choose Jesus the first time, but then you choose Jesus each and every day, and throughout your day, you choose to live for Jesus. I'm going to pray, and I'll invite the worship team to come up, and as we sing our last couple of songs, I want you to consider, are you choosing Jesus for real? Maybe you've never done it before, and you want to cross that line of faith. Or maybe you have chosen Jesus and you realize you need to choose him more often. And maybe you're kind of walking that fence of choosing and not choosing, of walking in the world and in the church. Today's the day of salvation. Today's the day you make the choice to follow him for real. Our God and our Father, we thank you for your Son. Your Son who is our Savior, who is our King, who is the only one whose death could pay the price of our sin. God, it's my prayer this morning that each and every one of us would choose your Son, that we would choose Jesus to be our Savior, we'd choose Jesus as the one we want to follow. I shudder to think where we would be without him. And so we're grateful for him, for the work he did on the cross. And we praise you for raising him from the dead. And that he's now sitting on the throne next to you. It's in his name we pray, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together and let's respond.
Now and forever.
have gone before us, and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name it stands above. Dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy.
Thank you.
if the day, today's the day that you want to choose Jesus, we want to celebrate with you. We'd love for you to come and meet us at the front after the service. Pastor Paul will be here, and Pastor Marcy was around. I'm here. We'd love to talk to you about your decision to choose Jesus. Or maybe you have chosen Jesus in the past and you just want prayer for some things going on in your life. We'd be happy to pray for you. Please come and see us. And would you greet Annika, celebrate with her in her baptism this morning. And greet Mary and encourage her as she begins this new chapter in her life, serving vocationally in ministry. It has been good to be together today. Now go serve our holy God and tell others about what he's done for you. Go in his name and his peace.